You're listening to episode 1 of season 2 of Business Unplugged, How to Use YouTube Ads.
All right, welcome back to season 2.
Do you think anybody knew that there was a season 1?
No, because he didn't tell anyone there was a pause.
Right.
But it all got a bit overwhelming, the fame of being podcasters and the fact that actually they were taking us a very, very long time to edit. So we had to have a quick reassess and work out a new system. But now we're back.
So this is officially season 2. If you didn't know, welcome back anyway.
Yeah, welcome back. Let's crack on to our YouTube ad special. And you might be thinking, I'm not interested in that. Fine, go away.
I'm not sure what to say about that. Yeah.
Well, do you know what it is?
Why are you listening then?
I think a lot of people are a little bit scared of YouTube and ads, and they think, oh, that sounds terrifying. But they're very powerful, some new features, and hopefully by the end of this, I'll have convinced you to spend a fiver on testing them. It's all you need. Not a very vigorous test, that. Maybe 50.
Yeah, there's definitely some baby steps you're going to recommend.
Massive baby steps.
A bit of a contradiction.
if that exists. So, right, let's have a look at YouTube ads first. Let's just have a few stats to start off with, because we like our stats.
Ooh, look at those stats.
Dave, how many people do you think use YouTube monthly?
I reckon monthly 500 million?
No.
No? Higher?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
They're all on it all the time? So a billion?
1.9 billion. So that's a lot of the world.
That's all of them that are on it. I thought 1.9 billion was the people who use it at all, but they're on it monthly.
Active monthly users.
That's a big number.
So it's massive. So it's almost caught up on Facebook there. I think Facebook was 2 a while ago. Who knows what it is now? It's probably gone down. Average viewer session. How long do you think the average person spends on it?
Half an hour, 40. My kids up the average, I reckon, for everybody. So I think an hour.
Yeah, 40 minutes.
Okay.
So Facebook was, when that hit the big time, was like half an hour. And that was amazing. Everyone was like, wow, this is the most, you know, no one's ever spent as long on a website on average. YouTube smashing that. How many percentage of small businesses, Dave, do you think are on YouTube?
20%? 20.
20%. How many do you reckon would be on Facebook?
A larger number, but I don't know what.
I haven't got the stat for that. I'm just asking you, roughly. If you're guessing.
I would like, on Facebook, as in just having a presence, they've got a page.
Yeah.
I'd expect more than 50%.
All right. 9% of small businesses are on YouTube.
Are on YouTube at all.
So let's put that into perspective.
Yeah.
1.9 billion users.
Yeah.
Average person's on there for 40 minutes, which means they like the channel. Only 9% of small businesses on YouTube.
I think I see where you're going with this.
Is that something that doesn't... Hello? Is anyone else? Go on YouTube. There's a lot of signs pointing to use it. That just brings us on to... Well, this is more about advertising than the channel itself. Mm. YouTube mobile ads receive viewer retention 83% of the time, which I was like, well, I have no idea what that means. This is startling, I've written that, given that TV ads average around 45%. So people are paying more attention to YouTube ads than they are to television ads.
I wonder how they measure that.
Well, actually, no. Through the on-demand stuff, they can tell because people skip ads and stuff now. And that gets recorded.
So they can look for patterns there.
Yeah.
Right, okay, fair enough.
So 95% of YouTube ads are audible versus Facebook's 15. So Facebook ads don't play music, you know, straight away. There's no chat, which everyone's like, oh, it's really convenient. But people are actually on YouTube to watch videos. So they're not sitting there with the sound off.
Yeah.
So they're happily... And the audio is the most powerful part because that's how your brain's taking a lot of the information. So if you want to advertise and actually have people watch it and listen to it, YouTube might be a better bet.
That's true, isn't it? So social media feeds, apart from YouTube, because that is social media, you would scroll through without sound on. But on YouTube, what on earth are you doing on there with the sound off?
People go on Facebook to waste time. Yeah. People go on YouTube to waste time with a reason. 51% of marketers run video ads... or marketeers, run video ads on YouTube, which is a lie. 51% run, but only 9% of small businesses use it.
That's a really weird stat, because it's neither a compelling, inspiring, or depressing stat. 51%, it's like, what are they over-representing the 9% of small businesses?
I don't know. I would say that stat was realistic if they went to a special YouTube-only advertising conference. Maybe 51% of the people there would be using them.
Maybe.
But so ignore that one if you see it online, because we've decided it's nonsense.
Ooh, look at those stats.
One of the reasons that we think small businesses particularly should just be using YouTube ads is because of basically branding. Brand. We don't like to look at them, and you can use them as a way of generating income straight off the back of a click, but for us it's all about brand YouTube and making people aware of you and then remember you and then think of you first thing when they come to mind,
because no one's ever going straight to a purchase unless they're aware of you in the first place. You might think, oh, I instantly bought the latest Apple product. You were aware of Apple for years.
It's easier for products. For business services, you don't just put an ad up and go, I need a business coach. This person says they're a coach. Where do I sign up?
They'll be fine.
There's like, you know, they're going to be great. Hang on a sec. They've 10 times growth their business in a week. These guys are going to be amazing. So what to prove the power of YouTube ads to you, we're going to go back to the maybe the 80s, 90s, 70s, 60s to a television show called The Generation Game. At the end of The Generation Game, there's a conveyor belt. And the contestants of the game show had to memorize as many things on the conveyor belt as they possibly could. And then
where
if they say them, they'd
going
win them.
With this?
So I've made you a Generation Game conveyor belt.
What?
It's 15 seconds long, which is apparently the average time someone spends on a website before they hit bounce and don't click anything. Again, that was just a quick Google search that came up with that, but sounds about right.
If you're just listening to this, Ed has plonked his laptop in front of me with a video I'm about to watch.
This is going to work visually. Audio, just hang back for 20 seconds and enjoy the Generation Game theme tune. Are you ready, Dave? So you've got to remember as many things as you can. Play along at home, folks.
Life is the name of the game, and I want to play the game with you. Life can be terribly tame if you don't play the game with two.
That's it. Whoa. Right, I hope you played along at home. Go. What did you get? Quick as you can.
Okay, I got dumbbells.
Yeah.
A hammer.
Yeah.
Can.
Yeah.
TV.
Yeah.
An Apple laptop.
Yeah.
And I think that's all I can remember. There was some weird stuff in there that I couldn't actually... Oh, plate. There's a plate.
All right. That's interesting.
Yeah.
So there's 30 objects in that video I just showed you flashing by, very probably a second each image you're seeing, so it's only quick flashes, which I think is representative of the speed of the internet. And there's only a few that doubled up, and one was a plate, which you named, one was a hammer, one was a TV, one was a can, one was a dumbbell. The only one that doesn't double up is laptop, and that's because it's Apple, and I knew when I put that in you'd remember it because it's Apple and their branding is so powerful it just destroys everything else.
I feel violated.
Yeah, well, that's why you need to do this, because Apple are very good at just getting into people's brains. So we'll put that online. Play along. Try not to dance. It's almost impossible not to enjoy Bruce Forsyth a little bit too much. What a showman. Why should you use YouTube ads? Well, first things first, Dave. They're flipping cheap. We've been getting less than a penny a view, which I didn't even know was possible on. So, you know, it was sort of half a penny a view. Or penny every two views on some of ours. It's also surprising. I know that your kids, when they first saw you in a YouTube ad, were a bit dumbfounded. Is that the right word?
Awestruck.
Yeah.
I'd like to think.
Because they'd only seen big brands there, and they were sort of like, whoa.
Well, YouTube is their TV. It was like, Dad's on TV. So I strung that out as long as possible before they realised that it can be...
That is why this is so good. Yeah. Imagine going back 20 years and going, I'll get you on TV and I'll charge you a penny every time someone sees you. Another reason you should use them is just because attention is so tough. That used to be the whole, takes 7 times to get your brand remembered. They say it's 14 now. I'm not sure who's calculating this or how, but that seems fair to me. There's a lot of stuff going on. So who should do them? SMEs wanting to build awareness of anything, whether or not that's a new product, just their brand. SMEs wanting people to remember their brand and retain it. People looking to build a following on YouTube or build an email list.
Yep.
People who are selling books, courses, want to generate leads, want to generate more website traffic, and want to sell products. So, if
but
you
that
fit
last
into-
one, I think that's the one that I think people have very high expectations of. The leads is a straight off the bat.
When I say leads,
seems like a trap to me.
I don't necessarily mean someone picking up the phone and calling you. I'm talking about the start of the funnel.
Yeah.
Which could be as simple as getting them into your remarketing, which we'll go in a bit, getting them to follow you on Facebook, getting your email, or getting them into some sort of system that you've got. Not get me Dan I want to speak to him now. I've just seen his video. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Sure, it's happened once. So let's get into the exciting part. Targeting. So this is the beauty of YouTube ads. It's just what you can do with them now. And it really is getting good with making sure the right people are seeing your videos. So the first thing you can do, these things called placements. So let's say you're a business coach and you've made some YouTube videos. You've got to think to yourself, right, I need to get these in front of the right audience. Who's watching business coaching videos? So you might put your video ads just on Tony Robbins' channel. So if he's got ads, you can put your video ads at the start of his, or Gary Vee, or any of these like sort of coachy people, even the smaller ones who may only have like 20,000 subscribers.
Yep.
You can just show the ads to them.
So you can piggyback their audiences that way. So
yeah.
Is there a, and that's common practice. That's not like a, you know, hack or something like that. People are doing it all the time, right?
All the time.
And is there a danger that you'll just be seen as the cheap cousin? Do you know what I mean? Because Tony Robbins is, well, that's Tony Robbins. So, and then you go on as a coach. Or is it because people are in that frame of mind that they may not want Tony Robbins, but they're thinking about those issues, so therefore they want someone either more local or whatever?
Well, what you can do is, you can go into demographics and localize it and really target this down. But if you're smart about it, you're not going to try and take the viewing from Tony Robbins. And you might just start your video with, hey, look, this next video is amazing. It's why I wanted my ad here. The only problem I have with it is I tend to find that small businesses in Britain, this is not applied to as much because of the way things roll. This is for bigger businesses. And actually, from working with small businesses, I've realized that you need to have these things in place. So why not check out the video? There's a banner next to it at the end. Give it a click when you're done. And if you didn't think it quite applied to your business, maybe my take will. Something like that.
Yeah,
so
right.
So you could tailor a video specifically
to another
video. That
could be quite disarming. Like, I'd be much more interested with that level of frankness than you would with somebody
saying,
hey, I'm also an amazing coach, etc. Yeah. Right, yeah.
And I think being aware that you're actually not what they came to see.
Yeah.
So that's one way of doing it. You can target an individual video in that channel.
Yeah.
So if it is very specific, you know, you could literally make a video for one video if you wanted. Then, of course, there's demographic. So you can target the location. So you may say, I want everyone who watches Tony Robbins videos in Hertfordshire, London, Bedfordshire, you know, the south of England, say, aged X, who watch this video.
So it's, you know, some poor American over in Portland or something, or some Chinese guy in Guangzhou isn't going, what is it? I can't do a combination of
don't
American
think Chinese
accent,
are allowed YouTube. So
actually, they're not. No. Well, it might turn up on WeChat. Who knows?
So yeah, that would be we're telling it. And the great thing about that is you're only showing it to people who are probably going to be interested in what you have to say. And paying nothing to do it. You might be paying, when you do placement ads like this, they're slightly more expensive, I find. So you might pay 8p a view.
Right.
But you might only get 30. But actually, that's okay because they're super relevant. So you can also, using this, target people who have already watched your YouTube videos already.
Yeah.
So someone's watched a few videos on your channel, hasn't subscribed. They see a whole different set of ads. So you can be more familiar. You can be warmer because you can assume that they know you. Rather than a lot of these ads where they get in and they're all very familiar. It's almost like you've got to come in at a slightly different level when they're cold.
Right.
Like when we make cold videos, we have less explosions.
We have noticed that works better.
And as we warm people up, we throw in more weird
explosions
stuff. Because they tolerate us. You can place them on a particular website. So this doesn't just show on YouTube. YouTube has an ad network, Google does. So you can put them on, I don't want to say it, but like the Daily Mail's website, if that's where you think the right people are. And you can just be where your audience are and they're alone. So that's pretty powerful. Targeting part two we have, it's called the audience.
Yeah.
So this is, you do this in Google's AdWords, and this is something that scares people, I think, because it looks like a spaceship.
Yeah.
But just take it easy and be gentle. You can call Google if you want.
Do it one step at a time.
Yeah. So with audiences, you build an audience like you do in the Facebook ad network, if you're familiar with that. So you can target topics. So you can say, I want to target business coaches again. It's also got this cool thing called a custom intent audience. And that is where you can actually hop in on people who are already looking to buy something. So say, for example, someone searched business coaches on Google. You can just target that keyword that's been searched on Google
right
through your YouTube ads.
I think that's the thing that people would expect most. It was the piggybacking of other audiences for other shows, I think, is surprising. But that's the one, I think. So talk us through that one.
You know, someone's decided they need a service.
Yeah.
Generally, they've gone Google straight away.
Yeah. Because Google and YouTube are connected, they're the same company, then
yeah.
It all
joins
up.
Instead of having to get them to discover you,
You can let everyone else on Google do the hard work and then follow them around with your video ads or your banner ads, just to get them in front. So it's putting what's potentially a top 10 Google search in front of people all around the web. Then there's custom affinity audience. This is kind of, I think, what people have expected it to do. This is a slightly more general one. So you might just say, I want people who are interested in golf. Now, they haven't actually searched it necessarily, but they've shown Google some reason why they would be interested in that topic, and it will show you the ads. So they're a little bit more general, not necessarily quite as targeted. It depends on the company that's using them, I think, and how you use them. So I think these are what originally it used to be, and I think people who might have tried it a while ago have gone, like, I know one of our clients tried it and it was way too broad, but now he's gone back on and he's like, oh wow, there's a lot more I can do here. Because the point with this is you should be able to get more targeted and actually spend less and get better results now as the targeting gets better. Now you can build these what's known as audiences, and, you know, test out loads of different ones and using keywords. You can even type in URLs of websites, so you might have your competition's websites. Put them in, and Google will build an audience based on what it thinks is relevant to that URL. Which is pretty cool.
That is.
But it's not like it's putting a video ad on their website. It's just targeting people who have shown interest in what Google thinks that website is about. So it might be marketing or video marketing.
That one's harder to understand. I don't quite know.
That's fair enough.
I don't quite know how that...
So imagine if you go on a web...
Am I being dumb?
No, it is hard to understand. YouTube's got you've got a website.
Yeah.
So let's say you're a video production company. Say you're one of our competition. I type in your URL into the audience builder.
Yeah.
And I put a few in. Hit save. It's not just showing ads to people who have only been on those sites. That would be amazing. But probably a little unfair. It's building an audience based on what it knows about that site.
Oh, I see.
So
right.
The people who kind of have been on it, you know, it's a marketing-based site, and they'll start to put it out.
So it takes all the bucket of audiences that have gone for that sort of information.
Yeah. So it's still slightly more general. For you. It's not as targeted as just putting on an individual video.
Yeah.
But it works in the, if you can...
Man, the potential for Google to be incredibly evil... I just
love the idea of
so
advertising on to everyone who's been on the competition's website.
Do you think one day they're going to snap and they just go, we're just going to turn full evil now and we're going to just market this company over this one and so on?
Probably. So you can even target through life events. So if you wanted, you could ping out a happy birthday message, or you could show a video to people's birthdays and be like, it's your birthday, that's amazing, now why don't you check out my course? You get them, you know, hook them at the front. So then the next part, and this is really good for recall, and one we're big fans of. So someone becomes aware of you, they find you, they click on your ad, they go away. They're on Google, they find you, they go away. The people don't just come back because they remember the pretty site. They might do, but often they need a little bit more. You know, it takes a lot to ingrain your brand on their brain.
So this one sends a video to them by post.
Yeah, and
you open an envelope, and there it is. Hello!
So this one, basically... this is part of the 14 touch points.
Right.
So
there are 14?
There was 7, and now there's 14. So let's say you can smash 7 of these out of your 14 quite easily. Possibly the cheapest way of doing it as well. And basically what you do is, anyone that's been on your website, you show them a video when they leave and go on YouTube.
Right.
You can do it with banner ads as well. It's called remarketing. You can also remarket anyone who's watched a YouTube video in particular, like a singular video or your videos. People who have subscribed to your channel, you can show them a completely new video.
I think this is the one that most people experience themselves day to day and know what it is. When they've been on a site or they've done something and they're getting remarketed.
I was thinking about this last night, and I don't know which one we experience the most because we're all doing different stuff. So I get a lot of awareness, then I click on it, and then I end up in their new funnel. So, yeah, you might be right, but... if companies are doing it well, you should have no idea where you are in the system. This is a cheap way of doing it. You can remarket people who have watched your YouTube videos, subscribed to your channel, liked a video, added a video to a playlist, shared a video, even created another list of people who have viewed your ad. So the amazing thing about this is you can use an awareness ad like we just spoke about. So you can advertise to people who are just on Tony Robbins' YouTube. They watch your video or they come to your site, they leave, they've sort of met you already. You show them a new ad, slightly more personal, and then you've got 5 or 6, say, different ads in there that are just rotating around. So,
and this is still, you've mentioned I've heard you talk about journeys before. This isn't journeys. This is remarketing still.
This is part of a journey, yeah.
It is part of a journey.
So part of that initial, like, they've just, you've managed to use YouTube ads to get someone new to interact with you in some shape or form. You now need to remarket to them with a slightly different story. So you can keep showing them the same ad that they saw straight away if you want, and that's fine. But really, they've experienced you. Why not show them something new?
Right.
So you could delve into a slightly different part of your service, or, you know, give them some more information, or push them towards a sign up for a course or something like that. But it doesn't have to be the same message over and over again.
And for journeys, you really need to be pretty savvy about that audience, right? Because you're going to get more and more specific.
Yeah.
Based on their...
It's a funnel, basically. It squeezes out the most relevant people, and you start a bit broader, and then they should self-select and keep moving through it. You can even show ads to people who have not visited certain pages of your website. So you're like, well, why is this person not going on the best bit of my site? Let's let them know it exists with some YouTube ads. One of the ways that we like to do it is actually you set up the tracking code on your website, which sounds scary, but if you've got a web person, they'll do it. If you've got WordPress, there's those little apps that make it easy. We just have that on, and you can set buckets of time. So I want it to capture people who've gone on a site for 30 days, 100 days. You can go up to 540 days worth of people. Now, you don't have to show them anything. If you've got those buckets there, you can always turn them on and go, look, we've got an offer on this product. Let's show everyone who's visited the product page in the last 6 months. Let them know.
I should point out at this point that we don't sell this service.
No.
This isn't a sales pitch, just in case you were thinking, oh, when they're going to sell the service, it's not going to happen. This is just our experience from Ed's knowledge of doing this for our business, and so therefore you should be doing it. There are things that we can point in the direction to go and learn about, but this is our experience. We're very positive about this. You should be doing it, basically.
Yeah, this is a result of the fact that we got blacklisted from Google because of a virus, and we lost lots of leads. And then when we finally fixed it and turned it on within 2 weeks, it had gone nuts and it all coincided. And it's the third time we've turned off the ads and then turned them back on
and
seen a
happens.
Complete spike. And I was just like, more people need to do this, especially small businesses, because it's so cheap. For the people who really want to track this and they're not happy with just awareness being which is kind of a metric a lot of the time you can't track. We can see it through bottom line and leads going up always. Conversions. So you put an ad on YouTube, a message, someone clicks on it, they sign up to your email, they go to a thank you page, boom, that's a conversion. Or they buy a product, that's a conversion. And Google track that. So you put in a little metric, and then when you go into Google Ads, you can see, oh, I've had 20 conversions. And you can even put a value to them. So if you're selling a product that's worth 50 quid, you can look at it and go, oh, profit, sort of thing.
So for those wondering how they get ROI, it's measurable. You can work it out. But I can't stress this enough, for awareness, even if you can measure how many people are watching, etc., it's really hard to put an ROI on awareness.
I just think it's
to be doing it.
Think of this: if I can get 1,000 people who are genuinely very interested in my topic or are searching and provide lots of value and keep being there, you know, start showing maybe new videos and giving them a positive experience on the site, that's all you're going to need, which in YouTube clicks and watches isn't very expensive. So it's not a case of being, you know, trying to get the whole world in. It's just getting targeted, and the more targeted, the cheaper. So that brings us on to this, which is gonna be called, this is the quiz of no name this week. It's called Isn't It Annoying?
Who's thinking no name? So we gave it no name. Couldn't think of no name. This is the quiz with no name. This is the quiz with no name. Shoo-be-doo-be-wow.
People get really annoyed by these. We've had complaints in the past. And that, and in all fairness, I was new at it. So I didn't realise you could actually cap how many times individuals see videos. Because it is annoying if you keep seeing
the same one,
the same ad. And the people that do it well, which we'll get onto in a minute, it's
not annoying. They limit it to a handful.
If you end up in a funnel for someone you're interested in, it's not annoying. So I'm going to name some brands.
Yeah.
See if you know them.
Okay.
You might not, so just say if you don't. First one, brand called Monday.com.
Now, you have mentioned them once before, and I went, no, I have no idea. I have started, I don't know if Google heard me think about this, but I've seriously started seeing them all over the place now. Yeah, I've not gone on their site, I've done anything. But anyway, I have started seeing them.
What do you
and
think
I realized,
they do?
No, but do you know what? I think it's like when you buy a yellow VW, you start seeing them everywhere. They do project planning for businesses, so you know where projects are up to, and you can give feedback and so on. It's really clever. I've started seeing their remarketing more.
How would you describe their brand from what you've seen?
Colourful, vibrant, playful.
Monday.com is a way for teams to track projects. Now, I think their ads are brilliant for a number of reasons. First thing is they're a software company, and it's not just animations. They use people from the company in the videos, so I actually feel like I know some of the team. The ads are great. They have loads of different ads. Now, I don't need this product.
Right.
So the targeting, we should need it. We have a similar solution that's free. We're not big enough, really. But I'm well aware of this product company. I like them. I like the way they portray themselves. It's playful. It's fun. And actually, it looks like a really good bit of software.
So how does awareness work for them in the case of you watching them? Because you're not going to buy the product.
That's a good idea. So what's happened here? They probably have an initial, they might have a custom intent audience. Right. So they may be advertising on, they could be advertising on, digital marketing gurus vlogs on YouTube.
Right.
So they might have individual channels that they're pushing people who they might think be interested in it, business stuff as well. They might have an audience of people who have been on certain websites, maybe the competitions and certain other sort of software. And then they might be remarketing to me because I've actually watched their ads past a certain point and I have been on their website. So there could have a three-stage attack, which actually means you need quite a few different videos. Otherwise, it was the same one banging your head against the wall. Talking about the same one, Squarespace.
I vaguely know that they're a website company.
What do you think of their brand based on what you've seen?
If you're buying website stuff and you're comparing it to other things, then they're the more edgy one.
Yeah.
There's more style to them.
Yeah.
I don't know about what that translates into, but that seems to be, compared to the only other one that I know of, which is Wix, which I do see a lot of remarketing.
Which is the next on the list. So, let's just do the pattern quiz emerging. Of no name question.
It's as if I knew what was going to happen.
Monday.com, is it annoying?
No.
Good. Squarespace.com, is it annoying?
No.
I'm going to go with yes, because I get that.
No, but I haven't seen many of them.
I get the same animation, non-stop,
I've only seen the Idris Elba.
Shame on you, Squarespace. Go and talk to the people at Monday.com and learn how to do this properly. Wix. Annoying or not annoying?
Annoying.
Yeah, really annoying.
But the reason isn't because I'm not in the market per se. I mean, I'm interested in website design to a point. So somehow, obviously they picked up on that because I would have searched for things of like how to do quick templates and things like that, right? But that's not it. It's the fact that it assumes I'm ready to buy by hammering me with it. So I can see how annoyed people would have been with our earlier iteration of banner ads where we were just doing it too much.
That's the problem. The people who aren't interested, if your targeting's not precise, it's going to annoy someone. But there's always going to be an ad.
We live in a world where you're going to get advertised at.
Yeah.
And until we change that and have some sort of, automated luxury
just knows what you want.
Well, everything knows what you want. Then without advertising anything, then
there's a way around this as well, which I'm going to teach after this section. Now let's do this part on basically setting this up so it's not annoying. So let's call this section "How Not to Be Annoying."
Don't speak with your mouth full. Take your elbows off the table. Don't pour salt on snails. Never poke a man from Wales. How not to be annoying.
Well, I really don't like it when you poke me.
First things first, you're going to need more than one video. 5 to 10, I'm going to suggest. Not only because you want to test them, you want different styles, different features, different messages, all under the same a sort of umbrella.
Right.
So you kind of want to push the same message out in different ways, potentially. So you might want to test out more playful things. You might want to test out one that's just purely animation. I would advise getting people in because the experience from Squarespace of having actors and animation versus Monday.com's team doing it, you watch it and you're like, oh, these guys are cool. Like, this is a cool company.
That does also, that plays into very much what we've found works over time.
Yeah.
You know, if you want a system that works, use your own people and get them used to cameras. It's just a fact of life.
Then set how often people see it. It's called frequency capping. If you're watching on the video, I'm going to show you now how to frequency cap. If you're listening, you might want to watch this. It's pretty simple. You can select at a campaign level. So a campaign will be the umbrella. And in your campaign, you'll have lots of different ads. And in each ad, there'll be different adverts. Campaign level, you can say, look, I only want an individual to be able to see three views of any video in the campaign. So it could have hundreds of videos in the campaign level, which is like the broadest level. So they don't see too much.
We always do this. You get to the point where it's so complicated. You go, it's super easy. And then you go, and it's really worth doing. And then you explain it and you go, actually, do you know what?
It's so, when you explain it, you realize why people don't do it.
I think what people would be worried about is that at any of these steps, something could go horribly wrong. And one, they'll get charged a lot, or they'll offend somebody, annoy someone, etc. And it's not knowing that. Is it that easy to stuff it up? Do you see what I mean? Or is it quite intuitive?
Yeah, you can set caps. You can say, I only want to spend £2 a day on this ad.
Okay, so there's some basic pratfalls to avoid.
Yeah.
But once you know what those are...
Setting up the costing and all that is just like a whole nother vlog I didn't want to go into, because I just want people to realise how magical this can be. The only problem is you need a video.
Okay, this is the bit where we're selling now.
Well, it's not. I've not done much information on here because, again, there's a whole other course on how to make videos at different levels and so on like that. But first things first, don't shoot it on your phone.
The production quality needs to match the services being...
Well, it's up to you. Would you go on a first date dressed in a bin bag? Well, you might, actually. I mean, some of your dating
stories.
I'm a
Kiwi. I mean,
that's the only thing I had. They were in fashion back then when you met Fiona. But that's the kind of idea. It's like first impressions do count here because you have 5 seconds to make an impression. So it's got to be relevant to them. The message has got to be clever. You're competing against a lot of a tat on YouTube. And then you've got to work out a way of getting them to watch more. So scripting it, coming up with a concept can be tricky, not impossible. But don't just blast out one of these messages going, hi guys, it's me, random internet man you've never heard of. Because it'll just suck and you'll go, this doesn't work. And it does, you've just done it wrong.
Well, thank you for getting all of this way. Like young Jenny once said, it's almost time to go away. But before you flee, try listening to me. Because it's competition time.
Competition time. We're going to give away a YouTube channel audit.
Which is? Explain.
Well, I've never done one before.
Yeah.
But
a great start.
Basically, if you've got a YouTube channel that you want to grow, I'll go through it. Because I do know a little bit about YouTube.
Can you have a look at my brain tumour? Well, I'm not qualified, but I'll have a look at it for you. Let's see what I can do.
Well, there's no one else around helping, Dave. So, you know, I might as well have a look. It's like looking under the hood of a car when you go to buy one. Everyone does it. They pop the bonnet up and then they're like, I have no idea what I'm looking at.
Definitely an engine in there.
I feel like I should be doing this. So, YouTube channel audit. So if you want to try and grow a YouTube channel or use it for your business, or you've been using it, or even if you're using it as a hobby and you're just a listener, that's fine. I'll go through it, look at your goals, what you're currently doing them, give you a load of tips on optimizing titles, search, how to get more viewers, how to use it better, basically.
In your defense, you have been doing an incredible amount of research and planning to devise ways to increase our own YouTube traffic, which is working, and so we can see...
We're also YouTube certified in that, so YouTube has given us the stamp of approval. I'm not just making this up.
Yeah.
I do know what's under the hood.
Yeah, I think you undersold that just a little bit.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. Both of us are YouTube certified, and in the last 6 months, written about 100,000 words on the topic. So, I mean, none of them make any sense.
They do. Anyway,
the only caveat is I need to do your audit live on a live stream on our channel. So it means letting people behind the scenes, because I want to show other people how to learn from your mistakes. Or not mistakes, you know?
Yeah, so delete those first 100 that you did on your phone.
No, don't.
Keep them.
And that's it for the podcast. Hopefully that wasn't too mind-numbingly confusing. A quick rundown. Very targeted. Put them in front of YouTube videos. Put them in front of people who have been on other websites like yours. Build little journeys, 3 or 4 step journeys. Warm people up.
And if you've listened all the way to the end, then please let us know what you think of the new 14mm lens that we're using, which was kind of cool. So it makes our hands enormous if we reach too close. It's a sweet spot about where we are. But before that, it's...
If you would like to take part in the competition, just email bizunplugged@gmail.com, our super posh official Gmail email. And you'll be entered and we'll pick a winner. See you in a couple of weeks.